Hi guys, today I want to talk about the widespread flood myth, also known in biblical history as Noah's flood. For well over a century, scholars recognized Noah's ark story having very close parallels to earlier Sumerian sources. The most famous is the Epic of Gilgamesh, dating back to 2100 BC. There have been many attempts to locate the sedimentary deposits left by the Great Flood. In this video, I use the Sumerian flood story, modern excavations, as well as climate and sediment information to trace back to this crucial event. Most flood records share a similar story about gods deciding to destroy mankind with a great flood. A benevolent god didn't want to annihilate all humans and revealed the plan to a virtuous man. Per God's instructions, this man built a big boat whereby his family, craftsmen, animals, and he survived. Afterwards, this man offered gods a sacrifice and was granted immortality. Cultures that shared this common flood myth were in or close to the Fertile Crescent and might have originated from a single source. In prehistory times, about 10 to 6,000 years ago, Mesopotamia was warm and humid, with reliable summer monsoon rainfall. At least 7,500 years ago, Mesopotamians used reed boats made waterproof with bitumen, a kind of tar. They built an extensive trading network on the Euphrates and Tigris. Traveling and trading between states and regions was prevalent then, and a good story was easily passed along. The earliest written records of the thrilling flood story were found here in Mesopotamian cuneiform. In Eridu Genesis, dated around 1600 BC, the Sumerian Noah, Zeusudra, was king of Sharapak, where he received a warning of the impending disaster. His counterpart, Inupshetim, was the flood hero in the Epic of Gilgamesh, which poem dates 500 years earlier. Here, Inupshetim is referred to as the Man of Sharapak. So, it appears the Great Flood occurred at Sharapak, which is current-day Tel Fara in Iraq. Sharapak is on a Lower Mesopotamia, a delta plain built up by sediment deposition from the Tigris and Euphrates. It is one of the flattest places on Earth. Most major Mesopotamian cities were built on the banks of the Euphrates, which was a freshwater source, trade route, and general lifeline. The Euphrates has changed its course many times due to avulsion, which is when an established river channel diverts out or changes into a new permanent course. As a result, cities on the riverbanks are highly susceptible to avulsion flood events. Geological records from this region also prove South Mesopotamia was vulnerable to seasonal flooding and heavy erosion from water and wind. In 1931, a joint team did an excavation at Sharapak and found a 0.6 meter or 2 feet flood sediment layer dated around 2900 BC. 2 feet of sediment is not an indication of a biblical flood. This cannot be the Great Flood. Maybe deeper core drills will reveal major flood sediment. Before we dig deeper, you might wonder how credible is the Sumerian flood story and can it be used as guidance to search for the Great Flood? The Great Deluge was mentioned several times in the Epic of Gilgamesh, which is loosely based on a historical king, Gilgamesh, who ruled Sumerian Uruk in 2700 BC. Besides this epic poem, the 4,000-year-old Sumerian King List also recorded a great deluge with pre-flood and after-flood sections. The King List recorded some kings who reigned for tens of thousands of years, which makes it difficult to take it literally. However, some mythical kings are supported by archaeological findings. For example, after the deluge, the 21st king of Kish on the list, Imabarajasi, is the first name confirmed by archaeological finds. Scholars also discovered artifacts associated with Imabarajasi and his son Aga with Gilgamesh, where Gilgamesh was described as the vessel to the Kish kings. Such findings have lent credibility to the Gilgamesh historical existence and the Sumerian king list. it shows that the list is not a successive list, where separate kings and kingdoms coexisted at the same time. The kingship moved among different kingdoms. On the king list, before the flood, the first kingship was at Eridu. After the flood, the kingship was first at Kish, then Uruk, followed by Ur. These are all proven archaeological sites, and their carbon-dated times are in line with this sequence. Gilgamesh was the fifth king in Uruk, and Imrikir was the second. Based on a clay tablet, Imrikir reigned between 34 to 3100 BC. That means the Great Flood happened 5100 years ago. The ancient city Kish is at the archaeological site called Tel al-Umayr in Iraq, and is carbon dated to be established around 53 to 4300 BC. Does that mean the flood happened 7300 years ago? Please hold that thought, and I'll come back to it later. Since we have potentially established that the Epic of Gilgamesh could be based on real events, I want to point out some important information it revealed about the Great Flood. The tablet describes a frightful storm on the Euphrates in daytime with black clouds, thunder, and lightning. The decks overflowed. The land was shattered like a pot. All day long, the south wind blew rapidly and the water overwhelmed the people like an attack. No one could see his fellows. They couldn't recognize each other in the torrent. The flood and wind last 6 days and six nights flattened the land. So there was a big storm and perhaps an earthquake, since the land was shattered like a pot. There were dikes on site, which means local people were already dealing with seasonal flooding. The dikes, however, were insufficient to protect against this great flood. A side note, archaeologists found a 7,000-year-old seawall in Tauris, Israel. This proves that some ancient people used dikes to fight floods. The one thing that really caught my eye was the description of the south wind. A south wind blows from the south to the north. Please note the Euphrates flows from northwest to southeast and discharges into the Persian Gulf. The south wind would have gone against the natural river current. Was the river flooding in the normal direction, north to south, or opposite where the south wind blew? The Euphrates receives most of its water from rainfall, melting snow and ice. If the Great River Flood was caused only by increasing water flow or discharge, then it would not change its flowing direction. Imagine a boat floating on a river. If the river current flows to the south, with strong wind coming from the opposite direction. That means the wind works as a counterforce against the boat's movement, which might make the boat rotate, tilt, or stand still. This was not how the story was presented, because Euphrates, where Noah's boat floated for days with the flood and wind. For a flood to be catastrophic and wiped out all settlements and people, the wind and the river current needed to be in the same or similar directions, which would create a greater force and therefore more damage. I think this is evidence that the Euphrates flows backwards during the Great Flood. Also, after the flood, the Sumerian Noah's Ark was stuck at a higher ground for days until the water receded. The Mesopotamian plain is fairly flat with a gentle slope from northwest to southeast. If the Great Euphrates flood flows in the normal direction, then the ark would have been carried into the Persian Gulf. The river had to have been running backwards from south to north, from a lower plain to a higher point, so the boat or ark could have gotten stuck on the mount. This is further proved that the river was flowing in a countercurrent direction during this particular flood. Can a river flow backwards? Yes. Although the reversal of river flows can seem dramatic, many rivers have flowed backwards for a variety of reasons. In America, both the Mississippi and Chicago rivers have flowed backwards several times in history. three earthquakes that struck the Louisiana Territory in 1811 and 1812 shook the ground so violently that the Mississippi River temporarily ran backwards, sucking boats along with it. More recently, in 2020, 2012, and 2005, hurricanes Laura, Isaac, and Katrina all caused the Mississippi to flow backwards. The latter two reversed the course of Mississippi for about 24 hours. These hurricanes caused major devastation wherein coastal towns were obliterated. In 2012, after Hurricane Isaac, the Mississippi River not only flowed backwards but also shown an increase of water to the extent that it was flowing faster backwards than it does forwards on average. The Mississippi ranks as the 14th largest river by discharge in the world, much bigger than the current Euphrates, which doesn't even break into the top 140. Even during wetter climate conditions in prehistory times, the Euphrates couldn't have had the same high discharge or water flow rate as the Mississippi. If hurricanes and earthquakes can lead to the reversal of Mississippi for 24 hours or so, they can make a much greater impact on the Euphrates. So it's conceivable that thousands of years ago, there was a huge storm, hurricane or earthquake, which struck towns along the Euphrates banks and made the river flow backwards in an accelerated speed for days. If the Euphrates flowed backwards, then the Persian Gulf seawater flowed into the freshwater river. Therefore, we should expect marine deposits near the estuary. There is indeed such evidence of marine deposits and transgression in multiple sites in Lower Mesopotamia. These sites include the ancient city of Eridu and Ur, which are more inland today. However, thousands of years ago, they were close to the coastline. This map is from a 2013 research paper. Scholars surveyed multiple areas near major Mesopotamian sites and drew a map with the estimated Persian Gulf coastline from 4000 BC. We can see the coastline past the ancient city of Uruk, approaching Shurippak, where the Sumerian Noah resided. This information correlates with another part of the Epic of Gilgamesh. After the flood, our hero looked for coastlines on the horizon and saw a region of land. He couldn't see the coastline because his boat has been pushed much further inland. Why did he look for the coastlines? Is that because he used to see coastlines in the city of Shurippak? Currently, Shurippak is pretty far from the coastline. But if Acheron deposits showed up in core samples near Uruk, then maybe there was a time that the estuaries extended even further northwards, close to Shurippak. Therefore, ancient people could see coastlines. Here is a map of Sumerian ancient cities that have discovered flood sediments. Some show marine transgression. Since we know the Great Flood happened before Gilgamesh and Imerker's time, which is 5,100 years ago, I highlighted the flat sediments that is old enough to be considered. With what's available, most flat deposits are not significant enough to be the Great Deluge, except for one site at Ur, where Sir Leonard Woolley discovered an 8 feet or 3.75 meter thick flat clay layer dating back to 3500 BC. In the 1930s, this was considered a biblical flood, even though the flood sediment layer was not found at the Sumerian Noah city, Shurippak, but 66 miles away. The flood layer found at Shurippak was much smaller and dated to be hundreds of years later. We know the Great Flood came before the Uruk kings at 3100 BC. The flood layers at Ur and Shurippak are from different eras. Thus, it's unlikely either indicates the Great Flood. On another note, geologist Carol Hill argued the depth of flood deposits does not automatically correlate to the depth of a past flood. The reason is major floods can cause erosion just as much as sediment deposition, and sediment might deposit in low areas during flood events. The best indicators of a major flooding event is likely by dating remains such as pottery, etc., both above and below a flood sediment horizon, or by carbonating the organic matter within that sediment. Such a comprehensive study has never been done for the ancient cities of Mesopotamia, especially not with the most recent technologies. Currently, there is not enough data to pinpoint the Great Flood's deposits. Let me circle back to the south wind. When do we see strong south winds in the Mesopotamia region? Analysis of paleoclimatic data suggests that southwest Indian monsoon strength for the Middle East region was greatest between 9,000 and 7,000 years ago, except for a brief cold and arid period around 8,200. Mesopotamia started to get dry and arid 6,000 years ago. Sediments and archaeological evidence indicate that between 3 to 2000 BC, this area became severely arid. Between 9 to 7000 years ago, Mesopotamia had more rain, wind, and environmental conditions for hurricanes and storms, all potential prerequisites of the Great Flood. The early Holocene sea level rise also happened during this time frame. At the end of the Younger Dryas cooling period, glaciers melted and there was a continuous sea level rise of 60 meters between 12 to 7,000 years ago. When rising sea level and the marine transgression backed up the river flow and prevented river floods from rapidly draining away, this could have played a critical role in the flooding history of Mesopotamia. So, between 8 to 7,000 years ago, the Mesopotamian climate was humid and warm. There were strong seasonal monsoons, which brought lots of rain, along with melting ice, which increased the Euphrates discharge volume. Moreover, the sea level rise causing marine transgression, pushing the estuary and the coastline to Uruk, and maybe even closer to Shuripak, thus backing up river floods. When considered all together, this time frame represents the most likely period for extreme flooding events in Lower Mesopotamia. It also matches the flood descriptions in the Epic of Gilgamesh: south wind, strong rainstorm or hurricane, and river backflow. Earlier, I talked about the pre-flood and after-flood Sumerian cities Eridu and Kish. Kish was carbon dated to be established 53 to 4300 BC. Some records claim that Eridu existed as early as 6500 BC. A sample at the base of the mount was carbon dated to be around 5700 BC. The time frame between the establishments of Eridu and Kish could indeed fit into the narrative that the Great Flood came 7300 years ago, before Kish was built. Let's wrap this up. By using the ancient text of the Epic of Gilgamesh, the Great Flood most likely occurred between 8,000 to 7,300 years ago, while the Euphrates flowed backwards due to a heavy storm and an earthquake. Deeper borehole drills are needed, especially at Shuripak, to study whether there was a great deluge that interrupted the continuity of the Sumerian civilization. What do you think? If you have any insights, please leave me a comment. If you like my video, please give me a thumbs up and subscribe. I have a wide range of topics that I want to share with you. This is Curious Being. I'm Tina. Thanks for watching and see you next time.